Hi, and welcome to part 11 about the series of videos about the security of quantum key distribution. In this video, we will now finally talk about the security of the BB84 protocol. And during the security proof, you will see a lot of the things that we have discussed and seen in the previous videos. The security proof of the BB84 protocol has the following structure. First, we will prove the security of the entanglement-based version of BB84, and then we will show that the entanglement-based version is equivalent to the preparent measure version. We do it in this way because it is easier to prove the security of the entanglement-based version than to directly prove the security of the preparent measure version of BB84. And here we will follow the proof that was presented by Peter Shaw and John Preskill in 2000. Because it is one of the easiest proofs that there are for the BB84 protocol. So first, let us remind ourselves of the entanglement-based protocol of BB84. We introduced this in the 7th video, where we talked about entanglement-based protocols. Okay, so the first step is that Alice creates two n-qubit pairs in the state phi+. This is the maximally entangled state. Then she randomly selects n of these qubits that will be used as check qubits. Then she selects a random classical 2n-bit string B. And whenever the bit in the string is 1, she applies a Hadamard transformation to her half of the qubit pair at that position. If you remember, this was like the equivalent of randomly choosing the computational basis or the Hadamard basis for the preparation of the qubits. She then sends the other half of all qubit pairs to Bob. Bob will receive the qubits and publicly announce the fact that he received them. Then Alice can announce the string B, which is equivalent to announcing her choice of measurement preparation basis. And she will also announce the positions of the check qubits. In the next step, Bob applies a Hadamard transformation to those qubits for where the string B has a 1. And then Alice and Bob measure the check qubits in the computational basis to estimate the error rate. If more than t errors occur, they will abort the protocol. If the number of errors is below t, Alice and Bob use the error correction code C1 and C2 to correct the errors in the remaining n bits. And they will obtain m copies of the state phi+. If you remember the entanglement-based protocol, we used the so-called CSS codes there, which were quantum error correction codes, and they were constructed from two classical error correction codes, C1 and C2. The last step of the protocol is then that Alice and Bob measure the m copies of phi+ in the computational basis, and this will result in a shared secret key. Okay, so in general, the goal of this protocol is to distribute m perfect copies of the maximally entangled state phi+. Because if Alice and Bob have the state, and they can be sure that they have the state, then they can simply measure it in the computational basis to obtain a secret key. Because since this is a maximally entangled state, it cannot be entangled to a third party. So Eve cannot have any knowledge of Alice and Bob's system. So the key they produce by measuring the state is automatically a secret key. And also, the key is perfectly correlated, so Alice and Bob will obtain the same bit strings when they measure the state. But in practice, the state that Alice and Bob share, row AB, will not be identical to the state phi+. It will be, hopefully, only close to the state. So we need a measure of closeness of two states, and we will use the fidelity here. We have seen this already in the last video, and the definition of the fidelity for a density operator and a pure state is this one. So you simply sandwich the phi+ state around row AB. And then we can use a theorem that relates the fidelity between these two states to the security of the protocol. So if you have a security parameter epsilon and a bipartite quantum state rho AB, such that the fidelity of the state rho AB to the state that consists of m copies of the state phi plus, when this fidelity is greater or equal to 1 minus epsilon squared, then the two bit strings that Alice and Bob can extract by measuring their shared state rho AB in the computational basis, these bit strings are epsilon secure keys with respect to an adversary who controls a purifying system of the state rho AB. I'll talk about this in a minute, what purifying system means. But first, this theorem gives us a possibility to extract a secret key from the state rho AB, which is only close to the maximally entangled state, if the fidelity is high enough. So the security of the resulting keys depends on the fidelity. And here there is a small typo on the slide. If you have m copies of the maximally entangled state phi plus, then you will get m bit strings and not n bit strings. Yeah. So these two letters should be the same. Okay, but what do I mean by purifying system? So a purifying system in general models the most powerful adversary. So if Eve holds a purifying system of Alice and Bob's shared system, then she has the most amount of knowledge about this system. And it's simply, the purifying system is simply that the composite system of Alice, Bob and Eve, it is in a pure state. So of course this pure state psi ABE has to fulfill the condition that if we trace out Eve's system, then Alice and Bob obtain their shared state rho AB. And as always, we get the state of Eve's system by tracing out Alice and Bob's system. Yeah, but the purifying system simply means that Eve holds so that the composite system of Alice, Bob and Eve is in a pure state. Okay, we'll shortly talk about how this can be proven, not in much detail, but I'll give you the ideas behind the proof. So if you remember, to prove that a protocol is secure, we had to get some expression like this. So the distance between the actual state of the system, rho ABE, and the ideal state, that is, that Eve's system, rho E, is in a tensor product with the remaining system, so she doesn't have any knowledge on Alice and Bob's system. And the system of Alice and Bob can be described by a maximally mixed state, because this models a completely random string, and Alice and Bob hold the same string. That's what is covered by rho UU. This distance has to be smaller or equal to epsilon. If we can prove this, then we know the protocol is epsilon secure. But how can we prove it with the fidelity that we have? So that's a theorem called Ullmann's theorem, which we didn't talk about and we won't talk about now because this exceeds the time that we have here. But you can look it up. This theorem tells us that there is a state psi E of Eve's system such that the fidelity of the composite system, the fidelity of the state of the composite system ABE, and the tensor product state of psi e and the m copies of phi plus, this is equal to the fidelity of the state rho AB with the m copies of phi plus. So yeah, the theorem tells us there is some state of Eve's system that fulfills this relation. What we can also use is that there is a relation between the trace distance and the fidelity, namely that 1/2 of the distance between rho and sigma is smaller or equal to the square root of 1 minus the fidelity of rho and sigma. And now putting these two things together gives us the following expression. So here we look at the distance between row ABE and phi plus, m copies of phi plus tensored with Eve's system sigma E. Then this is smaller or equal to the corresponding expression with the fidelity of these two states. And as we have seen above, this fidelity is equal to the actual fidelity that we look at, which we bound by, which we know is greater or equal to 1 minus epsilon squared. That's what the theorem says. So we put it in here, and if we simplify this, then we get epsilon. So we have shown that this expression above is smaller or equal to epsilon, but of course the maximally entangled state phi plus is not the same as the state rho uu. But you can see that if Alice and Bob measure the state phi plus in the computational basis, then what they get as a result is a key where both of them hold the same bit string, because the state phi plus is maximally, it's perfectly correlated. And also the key will be completely random, because in the state phi plus, 0 and 1 appear with equal probability. So the measurement of this state will yield exactly a perfectly correlated key for Alice and Bob. Okay, so this theorem tells us that once we can estimate the fidelity, then we can make statements about the security of the protocol. But how can Alice and Bob estimate the fidelity of their state that they share? So one problem is they cannot estimate the fidelity of the qubits, of the states that will form the qubits directly, because estimating the fidelity includes measuring the states. But what we can do is use a similar kind of argumentation that we had in parameter estimation, where we only checked how many errors there are in the check bits and could make statements about the errors in the key bits. But for this to be possible, the outcomes of the measurements have to obey arguments that come from classical probability theory. And this is not always the case when we deal with quantum measurements. We have seen this in the when we talked about the CHSH inequality, because there the inequality is a statement we derived from classical probability arguments, and then we used quantum measurements and were able to violate this inequality. But fortunately, what we can do is when the measurements only refer to one basis, then the outcomes obey arguments of classical probability. So what we will need to do is find measurements that Alice and Bob can use to estimate the fidelity that are defined only in one basis. So we need a two-qubit basis that we can use to define the measurements. And the two-qubit basis that we will use is the so-called Bell basis. Some of these states probably are familiar to you. For example, the phi plus state that we have seen through various videos. We have also already seen the psi minus state when we talked about the Eckert protocol. And defining the states phi minus and psi plus then completes the basis. Okay, so we will need this basis to define the measurement operators. But before we can do that, we need to talk about what kind of qubit errors can actually happen. So, of course, we can have bit flip errors. That means the bit 0 is flipped to the bit 1 and the bit 1 is flipped to the bit 0. We can also have phase errors. Phase errors don't do anything to the 0 state, but the 1 state gets a minus sign. And we can have a combination of both. So a bit flip and a phase error. This means that 0 is mapped to minus 1 and 1 is mapped to 0. These errors are generated by the Pauli matrices, where the sigma x matrix corresponds to bit flip errors, the sigma z matrix corresponds to phase errors, and the sigma y matrix corresponds to the combination of both. Okay, so having these possible errors in mind, The possible evolutions of the state file plus in the protocol are the following. Of course, we can have no errors. The state file plus simply transmits to both. Or we better have to say the one half of the state is only transmitted to buff. So errors can also only happen on this on the second qubit of the state. The first qubit will always stay the same because Alice simply stores it in her lab. Then the second possibility is that a bit flip error happens. Then the state phi plus is mapped to the state psi plus because Bob's qubit is flipped. A phase error will map the state phi plus to the state phi minus because Bob's qubit 1 gets a minus sign. And the combination of both will map the state phi plus to the state psi minus. So we have all states from the Bell basis here. And this means that the measurement operators for bit flip errors and phase errors can be defined in the following way. So the POVM for a bit flip error consists of the projector pi bf, that's defined here. We have the state psi plus and the state psi minus because these are the two states where a bit flip error appears. And the other POVM element is simply 1 minus this projector. For phase errors, the POVM consists of the projector pi pe, which consists of the two states that that appear when a phase error happens. And as above, the other POVM element is simply 1 minus pi p. Okay, so here we have two measurement operators that we can use to measure the errors that happen that are only defined in one basis, the Bell basis. This is very good, because then the outcomes obey the arguments of classical probability theory. However, there's a problem. The measurements in the Bell basis are in general non-local, because Bell states are non-local states. So implementing these measurement operators might be very difficult for Alice and Bob, because Alice only has access to her lab, and Bob only has access to his lab. But again, fortunately, there's a solution to this, because we can write these projectors that we have just defined in a way that they only have to implement identities and Pauli matrices. And these are operations that they can locally implement. But the outcomes obey the same statistics as if we had used the other definition of these operators. So this is how Alice and Bob can estimate the fidelity of their states with the phi plus state, and then they can make a statement about the security of the protocol. So coming back to the proof structure that I mentioned in the beginning, we have now successfully proved the security of the entanglement-based version of the BB84 protocol. And the next part is now to show that this version of the protocol is actually equivalent to the prepare and measure-based version. So, in the prepare and measure version of BB84, Alice and Bob only needed to prepare qubits, single qubits, and measure single qubits. So the first thing that we do is we remove the need to distribute maximally entangled states, phi plus. And we can do this by observing first that in step 8 of the entanglement-based protocol, the maximally entangled states are simply used to check the error rate in the protocol. And to check the error rate, we don't need to use the maximally entangled states. Instead, we can simply Alice can simply prepare qubits, send them to Bob, and then they will check the error rate of these qubits. So we replace the first step of the protocol by this step. Alice creates n random check bits and n maximally entangled states phi plus. Then she encodes n qubits as 0 or 1 according to the check bit. She then randomly chooses n out of 2n positions to put in the check qubits, and in the remaining positions she puts in one half of each state phi plus. Then we also have to change step 8 of the protocol. That's how Bob deals with these check qubits. So he simply measures the check qubits in the computational basis, of course, after he has gotten the information of where the check qubits are, and he publicly shares this result with Alice. Then they compare their values, and if more than t of the bits disagree, they abort the protocol. So in this way, we have simply been able to remove half of the maximally entangled states. And now, of course, we need to remove the rest of the entangled pairs. This is a bit more tricky. Okay, and for this purpose, we need to recall basics on Kaldebank-Shor's steam curves. So the rest of the proof will actually heavily depend on arguments that use properties of these CSS codes. So to follow the argumentation, I strongly suggest that you first watch the video I made on Kaldebank-Shor's steam codes or read something about these codes, because then it is much easier to follow the argumentation. Okay, but a small reminder of what CSS codes are. We had two classical codes, C1 and C2. C1 was a code that encoded K1 bits into N bits and was able to correct up to T errors. The code C2 encoded K2 bits into N bits, and the dual code of C2 was able to correct up to T errors. And from these two classical codes, we were able to construct a quantum code, the so-called CSS code. And this quantum code now encodes K1 minus K2 qubits into N qubits, and was able to correct up to T qubit errors, so phase flip and bit flip and phase errors. So this is the basic construction. The basic idea of the construction of CSS codes, and a code word in this code had this form. So we denoted it xk plus c2, and it was defined as 1 over the square root of the size of the code c2, and then we sum over all states we get from adding a code word in c2 to the code word xk we chose from c1. Now, what we need is that we can actually define a family of such codes. So, a family of nm CSS codes, which means that m qubits are encoded into n qubits. A family of such CSS codes of the code C1 of the code C2 that corrects t qubit errors is then defined as follows. So, the code words are now indexed by the code word xk from the code C1 and two bit strings v and w. These are n bit strings. And here we add in the code word, in the sum, we add a minus 1 factor to the power of v times y. And in the state, we also add the bit string w. In this way, it is possible to define a family of such codes that have the same error correcting properties. And this family of codes, so the code words in this family, have now the very important property that they form a basis of a 2 to the power of n dimensional Hilbert space. I will not show this here, but you can try to prove it on your own. And this property, we can use it to now express the state phi plus, or express our n copies of phi plus in this basis that the states of the CSS code family form. So the states here are usually denoted like this. I have rearranged the usual way of writing it a little bit. And we can now express all of these states simply with the states from the CSS code family. So we have a sum over all the over the code word xk and over the two n-bit strings v and w. And in this way, we have now expressed our phi plus states in the CSS code basis. This means this helps us to simplify the protocol in the following way. So in step 9 of the protocol, Alice usually measures the error syndrome corresponding to the parity check matrix H1 of the first protocol of the C1 code and the parity check matrix H2 dual of the dual code of C2. These measuring the error syndrome corresponding to these matrices tells her which kind of errors appear and where the errors are. This yields in random values that she gets for the bit strings V and W. And then in step 10, Alice and Bob do a measurement in the computational basis. This will yield a random element XK of the set of the cosets of the code C2 in the code C1. Which simply means that Bob's state collapses to a state xkvw, where xk, v, and w are all random. And this is the code word for xk in the family of CSS codes that we defined previously. This means that this is the encoded counterpart of an m-qubit state k. So in this family of CSS codes, encodes m qubits into these code words. That also means that instead of doing this whole procedure, Alice can randomly choose bit strings V, W, and K, encode the bit string K as a quantum state, and then send the corresponding code word XK VW of this family of CSS codes to Bob. Okay, so the resulting intermediate protocol where we have arrived is the following. We call it the CSS codes protocol, and it contains the following steps. So first, Alice creates n random check bits, a random m bit key K, and two random n bit strings V and W. She encodes the state K in the code in this family of CSS codes. She also encodes n qubits as 0, 1 according to the check bits. Then she randomly selects n positions out of 2n to put in the check bits, and she puts the encoded qubits in the remaining positions. She also selects a random classical 2n bit string B, and whenever the corresponding bit is 1, she applies a Hadamard transformation to the qubit pair. Then she sends the resulting qubits to Bob. Bob receives the qubits and publicly announces this fact. Alice announces the bit strings B, V, and W, and the position of the check qubits. Bob applies a Hadamard transformation to those qubits for which B, the bit in the B string is 1. Then he measures the n check qubits in the computational basis to estimate the error rate. If more than t errors occur, they abort the protocol. If the number of errors is below t, Bob decodes the remaining n qubits from the CSS code we defined. And finally, Bob measures the qubits he has to obtain the shared secret key K. Okay, what is good about this protocol? It is good that the protocol is secure. It is secure because we have shown that the entanglement-based version of the BB84 protocol is secure, and then we have successively modified the steps to arrive at the CSS codes protocol, but we didn't make any changes on Eve's system. So the security of the protocol still holds. We didn't do any changes that change the security statement. It's also good that it doesn't use maximally entangled states. It's only Alice and Bob like prepare and measure single qubits. What's not good about the protocol is that it uses quantum computing for the encoding and the decoding in the quantum error correcting code, the CSS code we defined. It also uses quantum memory because Bob has to store the qubits he gets from Alice until he gets the error correction information he needs to measure the qubits. So these last two points, they're not good. We don't want them in the prepare and measure based version of the BB84 protocol. And also in general, we don't want them in a practical QKD protocol, because at least at the moment, we don't have access to perfect quantum computing and perfect quantum memory. Okay, so we have to further modify the protocol. We begin with the observation that Bob only cares about the bit values of the encoded key and not the phase. So if a phase error happens to the qubit, he doesn't care. Because even if a phase error happens, the qubits are still perfectly correlated. That means he doesn't need the string V to correct the phase. So Alice doesn't need to reveal it. And that means the state that she sends changes. So we have now here the state she sends only depends on the code word XK and the string V, and not on the string W, and not on V anymore. We sum over all the possible values of V. And then we can make some we can input the definition of these states and modify it a little bit such that we arrive at this lower expression. And this state is now easy to prepare classically. We don't need quantum computation anymore to do the encoding, because Alice can simply choose a code word Y from the code C2 at random and construct the state XK plus Y plus W. This doesn't need any quantum computation. On the other hand, on Bob's side, Bob now receives a state xk plus y plus w plus some error denoted e. In the previous protocol, Bob first decoded the state and then measured the resulting state, but instead he can directly measure the state when he gets it and do the error correction classically. So the measurement will give him a string xk plus y plus w plus e. And first he will correct it with the information w from Alice. So correction simply means he subtracts the string from his string. And then he corrects it with the code C1 that cares about the bit flip errors to the bit string xk plus y. And he can do all this without any quantum computation, because he only does classical error correction. Remember that the code C1 itself is a classical error correction code. Okay, now we still have to remove the encoding step on Alice's side. So instead of choosing the code word XK from the coset, she can simply choose the state XK, the string XK from the code C1. That means we don't need Y anymore. Plus, XK plus W is now a completely random n-bit string, because XK is the code word of the code C1 and W is a random n-bit string, so the result will be a random n-bit string. And the alternative scheme to the preparation step we described before is now that Alice simply chooses a random n-bit string x. She sends the corresponding quantum state x to Bob, and then she will send x minus xk as error correction information. On Bob's side, this means the following. He will receive a state x plus some error. He directly measures it, as we described before. Then he uses the error correction he got from Alice to transform the state into the state xk plus the error state, into the string xk plus the error string e. And then he can use the code C1 to correct the errors and obtain the string XK. And this is all using classical error correction. Alice and Bob don't need to do any quantum encoding anymore, because we only use the classical codes. What we have achieved is now that the check qubits and the key qubits are prepared in the same way. And the very last obstacle that we have in our code is the Hadamard transformation. The Hadamard transformation doesn't appear in the prepare and measure version of the BB84 protocol, and also it is a quantum operation. But it's very simple to remove this one. We can, when Alice prepares the state, she can simply do it as she does in the prepare and measure version of the BB84 protocol. She can randomly choose between the computational and the Hadamard basis for preparing, and then on Bob's side, he can also simply randomly choose one of the two bases to measure the state. This will add a sifting step where Alice and Bob have to check if their choice of bases coincides, and in general they will discard about half of their bits in this step. That means to achieve the same amount of key in the end, we now have to start with 4n bits instead of 2n bits. And also Alice has to wait with her choice of check bits until after the sifting, because she first needs to wait which bits are discarded. Okay, so we have now finally arrived at the secure version of the BB84 protocol. It is like basically the same protocol as the prepare and measure version of BB84 with some small cosmetic changes. Okay, so let's go through it step by step. Alice creates 4n random bits. She encodes each of these bits either in the computational or in the Hadamard basis, according to another random 4n bit string B. So if that bit string has a 0, she encodes in the computational basis. If it has a 1, she uses the Hadamard basis. She then sends the resulting qubits to Bob. Alice then chooses a random code word XK from the code C1. Bob receives the qubits, he publicly announces this fact, and he directly measures each of the qubits, either in the computational or in the Hadamard basis, chosen at random. Then Alice announces the bit string B that contains her choice of bases for the preparation. Alice and Bob will compare their basis choices and discard those bits where they have used different bases. After this step, there will be about 2n bits left, so half of the bits that we have started with. Alice then randomly chooses n of these bits to serve as check bits and tells Bob the position of these bits. Alice and Bob now publicly compare the check bits, and if they find more than t errors, they will abort the protocol. Otherwise, they continue and Alice is left with the, that should be a small n, n bit string x, and Bob with the n bit string x plus the error string. Alice announces the error correction information x minus xk, and Bob subtracts this from his string, and then he corrects the result with the code C1, so he obtains the code word xk. Now, Alice and Bob will compute the code set to which xk belongs in order to obtain the final key k. Okay, you can see there are some differences to the prepare and measure version of the BB84 protocol. But these differences are basically due to the fact that now this protocol also includes the error correction and the privacy amplification steps that we have basically left out in the previous protocol. We have only said that they have to be done, but we didn't specify what has to be done. And here, the error correction happens because they use this code C1 to do the error correction. And privacy amplification happens in the last step. So Eve might have gained some information on this code word XK through the whole protocol, but She doesn't have any knowledge about the code C1. This code is only known to Alice and Bob. So by computing the code set to which XK belongs, they transform this code word XK into the key K, and Eve doesn't have the knowledge to do the same transformation. This is only known to Alice and Bob. So here we have already included error correction and privacy amplification, and that's the reason for the small differences to the prepare and measure version of BB84. Okay, a last thing we need to talk about are that there are some caveats about this protocol and its security proof especially. So the first point is that the proof is only for an ideal protocol. So it assumes that we have ideal devices and everything happens exactly according to the protocol. This does not include photon number splitting attacks, of course, because they attack the implementation of the protocol. Also, there's no statement about the efficiency of decoding. We only say that we use the code C1. But for practical use, C1 must be efficiently decodable, like in the sense of computational efficiency. If decoding takes years, then this is not a very practical use of the protocol, even though it might be secure. Then the last point is that there is no upper bound for the tolerable eavesdropping in the protocol, in the security proof. The original paper that I mentioned in the beginning has an estimate that this the protocol can tolerate a bit flip and phase error rate of about 11%, and they conjecture that when using actual quantum computation and quantum memory, that this rate can be made even higher. So we have now seen the security proof of the BB84 protocol, and we've had to deal with a lot of different problems that show that proving the security of a protocol in general is not easy. Also, what you can see from this security proof is that this proof, it was very specific to this one protocol. It used a lot of the specifics of exactly this protocol. So this is not a technique that one can use in general for every protocol. So proving the security of a protocol is always finding the right techniques that exploit the special properties of the protocol to make statements about it. And because this now was a security proof very specific to this protocol, in the next video we will see some other techniques, like some techniques that can maybe applied in a like more generally, and especially techniques that use entropies, which we have talked so much about. So now we really want to see how they can help us to make security statements about protocols. Okay, so thank you for watching this video. It was a bit longer than the previous videos because I wanted to put the whole security proof in one video. And I hope you have enjoyed the video and you have learned something, and I hope to see you in the next video.